In this video, I will explain why in some cases solid aluminum bars might be for hobby CNC routers a better choice than extruded profiles. I will show you how to avoid that your valuable linear bearing blocks are destroyed by chips and dust, and if you want to know how manufacturers recommend to mount their linear rails, watch till the end. I was really surprised when I tried this. Hello and welcome to my channel. This is part 2 of my DIY CNC router build series. And today I will talk about why I have chosen massive aluminum blocks for the machine bed and not extruded profiles like in so many other DIY builds. In case you haven't seen part 1 yet, where I explained a little bit my background and the motivation for this build, I have linked the video in the description below. One of the biggest constraints for my CNC routers is the size of my shop. I only have one corner left for this build and I have to maximize the available space. This is why I have designed the machine with two board screws under the table and not on the sides where they could connect directly to the gantry side plates. This would have increased the overall width of the router or, with a given depth of the workbench, reduced the available working area. Board screws under the table are as well better protected from chips and dust, and I have made good experience with this design in the past. But there is a downside to this design. You need to have a plate under the table where the board screw nuts are connected to. Because of this, you can support the table only on the outer ends. This leads to a limitation in size because the whole machine sags under the weight of its own gantry. I have scaled the design of my previous router to the new size of 1250 by 700 mm work area, and I have used in the beginning the same design. Extruded profiles plus a mounting plate for the linear rails. But the gantry became wider and heavier too, weighing a total of 120 kg now. I have checked the deflection of the profiles under that load and the supported span, and the maximum sagging would have been 0.1 mm, constantly changing depending where the gantry is. Now you can argue that this is absolutely nothing, especially for a woodworking router, and I would totally agree. Still, I wanted to try something different, something better. And I checked my own machining capabilities and thought I might try something crazy, solid bars instead of profiles. So I redesigned the machine base accordingly and compared the cost of both designs. And to my surprise, they were not too far off, even with the better end for the solid bars. And with the new design, the sagging would be reduced to less than 0.03 mm, or about a quarter of the profile design. So that was good enough for me. And at that time, two friends out of my Insta community approached me about a community project, means building three machines at the same time. And since one of them is a professional CNC machinist with access to proper machining centers, the decision was made. We all go crazy. So we split the workload and he agreed to make the big and heavy parts for the base. A big shout out to his boss and his company, Saffe Zerspanungstechnik, to let him use their equipment for this build. I was happy too, because machining such big parts to precision would have been a real challenge for me. In the meantime, all the machine parts and the components are here, and I could finally start with the build. And this is what I will show you now. But before I start the assembly, there are a few things to prepare, like the linear bearing blocks. When you have an open rail design and chips can fly on the rails, or when your woodworking router does not have a good dust collection, I would highly recommend that you add extra seals to the blocks. Most brand manufacturers offer a variety of extra seals for the blocks, depending on different exposures. I went in this case with a medium dust protection, which is basically a double seal with a metal plate. The assembly is not so complicated. You either have to replace the existing seal or, like in this case, add additional ones. In the kit are the new seals, longer grease points and plugs, longer screws and lots of little spacers. At first, you remove the old grease point and plug, and the two screws that connect the seal to the ball cage. Don't worry, the balls will not come flying, they are still in their loop, even with the seals being off. My machine is placed in the corner and I have very limited access to the standard grease points. That's why I have a lubrication through the gantry side plates. I will explain that feature in one of the next videos, but it requires that I drill a new grease hole in the cage. After that, it is child's play. The seals have alignment features and you cannot misplace them. First comes the additional seal, which is stacked on top of the old one, and then comes the metal plate. The plate has a round over side from the stamping, and this is the side that I normally place outwards. The spacer go in between the plates so that you cannot squish the seals when you tighten the screws. After this, you screw everything together again and place either the plug or the grease nipple with the longer thread in the open grease point. And with this, the first side is already done and you can repeat the same process on the other side. This is a little extra effort, but nothing compared to changing a defect bearing block on the machine. Ask me how I know. After all the seals have been added, I mounted the linear rails. One thing I have never done in the past was to properly prepare the mating surfaces, other than cleaning them with some alcohol. But I got me a pair of PFG stones lately, and so I thought this time, hey, let's do it the way the manufacturers recommend. You first clean one stone with the other until you hear a very smooth sound, and then you go over the surface you want to clean. And the machine mounting surface from my friend sounded really smooth. After the mounting surface was done, I prepared the underside of the linear rail. I first cleaned the excess oil from the transportation protection, and what happened then really surprised me. But listen for yourself to my recording. That's exactly the reason why you do this. If you hear the sound, there are some high spots, still some burrs. Oh yeah. But now, this sounds really smooth. So, despite this not being a cheap no-name rail, there were still some high spots and burrs on the underside. They probably would have worked themselves into the softer aluminum during the mounting process, but hey, we all try to have accurate machines, and especially when you mount your rails on a steel surface, I highly recommend you clean both with an oil stone or a PFG. These linear rails are not perfectly straight out of the box, and the easiest way to mount them accurately is to have an alignment edge. I have designed these bars with two straight shoulders for the rails to be pushed against, and they have been machined all in the same setup and should therefore be perfectly parallel to each other. I start with one rail first, in the middle, and work my way to the end. Then I repeat the same process on the second rail. As you can see, I have mounted off-camera a lever dial indicator so I can measure the parallelism of the rail to the top of the beam. I have checked that before with a 1.5 meter straight edge and an 0.05 millimeter feeler gauge, and it was spot on. And folks, bear with me, I don't know what you take from this video, but I've learned that I have to improve my camera skills. So you have to trust me when I tell you that the accuracy is within plus minus 0.01 millimeter, and that is absolutely fantastic. So hats off to my friend who machined this, absolutely amazing. And finally, I confirmed everything by mounting a gantry side plate. I have two reamed holes for dowel pins, aka broken end mills, on the inner side for the plates to rest on the blocks. This way, they are already perfectly aligned vertically. Someone made a comment that two rails is a poor design because it is over-constrained and I should rather use bigger rails. Well, my gantry and my Z-axis have as well two rails and four blocks, for the same reason I use them here, to eliminate bending moment. Lateral stiffness is one of the weakest points of gantry-style routers, and this design addresses this issue. I will explain that in the video about the gantry itself, but until then, you can hear how smooth the axis runs. And these are bearing blocks with medium preload, by the way. So finally, after the rails are mounted and perfectly straight, it is time to cover the bolt holes. These little caps should not be pushed deep inside the holes to cover the screw, but they should sit flush with the rail so that the seals have a smooth surface to ride on and that no chips or dust inside of the hole can enter the underside of the block. I use a piece of laminated plywood and a dead blow hammer to push them in place. And in case you wonder, of course, before adding the caps, I tightened off camera the bolts with the recommended torque. And this sums up today's video. If you like the design and want to see how the rest will come together, give it a thumbs up, subscribe to the channel, and hit the notification bell so you don't miss the next video. Part 3 will cover the assembly of the frame with a very special challenge of an uneven desktop to build on. Also, please leave a comment below what you think about this project in general, and since this is only my second YouTube video, any suggestions for improvements are welcomed as well. Stay tuned and see you next. That is my workbench.